London. The time, 1843. The season, that of jollity, of festivity and charity, holly and berries and goodwill to all men, with perhaps one exception. And it is with this exception that we are concerned in our story. The exception is Ebenezer Scrooge.
Your faces, your hands, everything has got to be enormous, because it's not just us four watching, it's going to be 40, maybe 50, maybe 400.
Chimney, chim, chimney, chim, chim, cheree. A sweep is as lucky you can be. Chim, chimney, chim, chimney, chim, chim, cheroo. Good luck will rub off when I shake hands with you.
This is the life of the chimney sweep. We sweep and we sweep until we weep.
I can get your trousers up. I need something exciting in this studio. Hello.
You want to see my velcroed underpants?
Get them off!
They're coming off.
Scrooge, a duvet. It's been fixed.
Brilliant.
Who the fuck?
I'll see you later in the 11.
Let me demonstrate the...
You're late, guys.
Acting.
Okay. Well done, excellent. We're going to do that when we get to it. Don't worry now. So it needs to find a home to live off stage, and we will work out as we're doing it how these things happen. That's what the tech runs for. Next, we're going to go up tonight. Is everybody ready? Can we come out front, please?
Cratchit!
Yes, Mr. Scrooge. One time slum landlord turned moneylender and estate agent.
How can I help you, Mr. Scrooge, sir?
Cratchit, my long-serving, innocent and faithful servant, earning barely enough each year to feed his small family or take care of his little son, Tiny Tim, who's had a terrible affliction since birth. Would you like a cup of tea, Cratchit?
Oh, yes, please, Mr. Scrooge. That would be most kind, Mr. Scrooge.
Then, catch it, Cratchit. Oh.
Thank you, Mr. Scrooge. That was most refreshing.
Well, I think we all need a good laugh from time to time, don't we?
Oh, yes, Mr. Scrooge. Oh,
please laugh, Cratchit.
Ha, 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 ha.
Yeah, I think we all feel so much better, don't we?
Oh, indeed, Mr. Scrooge, I'm well refreshed.
Then you will be pleased to pay me a farthing for the tea.
But Mr. Scrooge...
I know what you are thinking. Why isn't Mr. Scrooge charging me for the broken cup? Well, I'll tell you, it is Christmas. Since our whole world seems to go quite mad at Christmas and give things for no return, I shall not charge you directly for the broken cup.
Why, thank you, Mr. Scrooge.
I shall instead take it from your wages of next January. It will be threepence.
But that is my wage for January.
You will receive a higher wage next year.
Oh, that is most generous, Mr. Scrooge.
It is business, Cratchit, not charity. I make great deals, Cratchit. You will receive an extra farthing per month, for which you will work an extra hour per day.
I do not have the words, Mr. Scrooge.
Then do not try to waste any more air speaking them. Now get back to your desk and do not trip on the carpet.
But we don't have any carpet, Mr. Scrooge. You say it's quite unnecessary.
Then do not trip on the floorboards. Be off with you.
That is something I wanted to ask you, Mr. Scrooge. I was wondering, since today is Christmas Eve, if I might leave work a little earlier than is customary?
You say? We have a legally binding contract, Cratchit, between me, a gentleman of honour, and you, whom I suspect now to be trying to worm Weedle and wriggle from his contracted obligations to the man who keeps you in home and food.
Do I take it, Mr. Scrooge, that that is a no?
Take it how you will, Cratchit. But if you leave one moment earlier than you have pledged in writing, you will not work for me again.
Thank you, Mr. Scrooge.
Now, who is this? I did not expect visitors. See who it is.
Good evening, Madam Sir. I can see that you are two small part characters introduced not only to show the miserliness of Mr. Scrooge, but also to illustrate the appalling treatment of the families of wrongdoers in Victorian society. How may we help you?
Good evening to you. I must say I'm very impressed to find you still at work on this time on Christmas Eve. We wonder if you are aware of the terrible plight of the children of adults in debtors' prison. Do you know that one farthing would pay for such a child to have a holiday sitting outside the prison for a whole afternoon?
Did you know, madam, that your interruption of my clerk's work has now cost him the very same farthing with which you wish us to enrich the undeserving offspring of the feckless?
Good gracious, sir, do you not realise that it's Christmas? Time to reach out to your fellow man.
And woman.
Indeed, and woman. And to open your heart, sir, and indeed your wallet.
And purse.
Indeed, and purse. And think of those less fortunate than yourselves. Dig deep into your trouser pocket, sir.
And skirt.
Indeed, skirt, but he's not wearing a skirt.
I know that, but you keep talking as though everybody's a man. Half the world are women.
Hey!
Yes, but this fellow is a man.
I know that. But it just perpetuates the assumption that men are somehow superior and women do not deserve equal rights.
I wonder if I might say something.
Yes.
The lady is, of course, quite right. The world of commerce was created by men for the benefit of men. Women cannot even borrow money on their own account. It is disgraceful.
Why, thank you, sir. Do you hear that, you misogynistic old dinosaur?
It is disgraceful because I can only cheat, swindle, rob, con, dispossess, etc. half of those I might. If the law were a little more equitable towards the fairer, your good self excluded, madam, sex.
Would you like to make a donation, Mr. Scrooge?
I will give you a tip.
Oh, that's very generous, thank you.
A piece of advice! Do not be fooled by the mawkish drivel that is hawked about at Christmas. It is a cold commercial assault on our pockets. It has a businessman I recognize instantly. I must say I rather admire. But I'm not fooled, and that is the difference. Now be gone. If those children wish warmth and shelter, they can join their parents in the debtor's jail. The treadmills are awfully good for the fitness, I hear.
Oh, well, in that case, we will sing you a Christmas carol to wish you good cheer. We wish you a Merry Christmas. We wish you a Merry Christmas. We wish you a Merry Christmas.
Cratchit?
Yes, Mr. Scrooge?
I'm feeling much better now. You may leave.
But that's 11 minutes early, Mr. Scrooge.
Indeed. And you do not need to pay for the tea spilled by those two until next year. Come on, be off with you, man.
So that the tireless excellence of your housework in such terrible conditions is made clear.
Well, thank you both. But where is Tiny Tim, whose affliction since birth has been used to elicit sympathy and to hammer home the lack of social care? He's been like this from ever so young. The doctor says he has a hip complaint and won't develop like other people. Ah, you can hear him coming now. It breaks the heart to hear that terrible sound that he makes from that contraption that he uses to get around on.
Hey, Ma, hey, Sister Grown. I have a flat white and avocados on toast. Where my fox would be safe there? Looks like there's some pretty dicey dudes out there.
Oh, poor little mite. You'll have water flavored with dust and ground flies. Your fix will be perfectly safe in here. No one will lick it. Now sit down. I will give you a crust with wood shaving paste to keep you going until your father gets home. I must put some flesh on your bones.
Oh, but Mama, nobody gets beefy and built up these days. This is so the new aesthetic. Sharp, skinny and smooth. If there are no avocados, I'm not interested.
I don't understand a word you say these days. Your hip complaint must be getting worse.
Yes, we love it when Dad comes home and we're all together.
My ideal children. He'll be home in 11 minutes, no doubt bringing a marvellous treat for our dinner.
Hello, my loving family!
Hello, Daddy!
Oh, Paul! It's lovely to see you 11 minutes early. But I do worry you've had trouble at work and that Scrooge has fired you.
Quite the contrary, Mr. Scrooge has given me 11 minutes off for Christmas!
Hurrah! Hurrah! Hurrah!
Oh, my splendid normal children, what a lovely
What a difference from the awful condition which Tiny Tim, my favourite child, though I should not say so, is forced to live.
Oh, like, hey, Pa, how's the rocking world of the salaried slavery, you old square? Did you bring the avocados?
He's been like this all morning, Bob. He just gets worse. Look at the state of his beard!
Hey there, little fellow. A big cuddle for your dad. Here's a fist, old man.
Right on, dude. That's my little fellow.
Don't worry, Mrs. Cratchit. He'll be fine.
But will he ever be normal, Bob?
Better than normal. Once we've all sat down and had the biggest and best Christmas dinner ever. But now, let's eat what I've brought home.
What is it, Dad?
Yes, let's see.
Ta-da! I popped in at the Ginger Pig on the way home, and they had these wonderful off-cut pig's noses with all the hair still in.
Oh, Bob, it's like living in the Dorchester sometimes. You do have a spoiled.
Right, well, if there are no avocados, I'm out of here.
If he goes on like this, Bobby's going to fade away.
Don't worry, Mrs. Cratchit. I'll save him some. But come on now, let's all tuck in.
What old Scrooge should we do for Christmas, Dad?
Now, don't you worry about Mr. Scrooge. He pays my wages, and very promptly. If it wasn't for him, we wouldn't be able to tuck into these wonderful crispy nostrils.
But you do wonder, don't you, what he does with himself on Christmas Eve? I suppose we'll never know. Oh well, let's just put some more dried rats on the fire for warmth.
Visitors?
Ooh, I must adjust my straps. You never know who it might be.
Good evening, sir.
I wonder.
I'll do this, Bob. Last time you did it, we had tea poured over our heads. Good evening, sir, but it is Madam, isn't it?
What are you suggesting? Beards are very fashionable. Now, what do you want? Out with it!
Well, I can see that you're really kind and generous people. We're collecting for the families of the poor and destitute.
Well, we're poor and destitute, aren't we, Dad?
Well, suppose we are.
So what have you got for us? Oh no, you misunderstand me. We're collecting from you for them.
But we are them!
Oh, this is really most awkward. Perhaps you could give some money to us, and then we give it back to you.
Oh, I've got something for you.
Have some tea! Let's run!
It is I, Ebenezer, Jacob Marley.
A speaking knob!
I prefer knocker, if you don't mind.
Knocker, then. What of it?
I only appear here to gain your attention. Apparently, you and I need to talk.
Well, this is not a good time. In fact, there is no good time to talk to you, since you've been stone-cold dead for the last 7 years. I may be a little bit short of company, but I think I could do better than a corpse as a companion. Now, be off with you! Choo! Speaking knockers, what rubbish. It'll be theatre in the pocket next. No. I need a good honest bowl of broth to drive these foolish images from my mind. What? What? Who is that? Who's that? If you're another charity collector, you will receive only a blow of my stick. You cannot come in. The doors and windows are locked, and I have my great staff in my hand.
Oh, the boast, weren't you, Ebenezer?
Who are you? How do you know my name?
But I just told you. Surely you recognize the man you worked with for so many years.
But you're dead now. I had the great pleasure, excuse me, the distress of making sure you were 6 feet under good heavy soil. You are not real.
In that case, I can do this.
Oh, that was nothing. I was a buzzing insect, you were a flying on Amiga wasp.
Well, how about this?
I bumped into the table, that is all. You are not real and could not have kicked me.
Excellent. I've always wanted to do this to you, miserable old git.
All right. You may be dead, but you make your point. Well, what do you want with me and why do you wail?
I've got a little musical group on the other side. Jacob Marley and the Wailers. Do you think you'll catch up?
I fear you will wait in vain. What do you want? I'm short of time. Come on.
Indeed you are, Ebenezer. Short of time if you wish to avoid the endless misery that these people are enduring. Look at this. This is like a theatre in my pocket. This is a show called Gogglebox. It is the windows, the horror of your future.
What nature of hellish torment is this?
This is the seventh level of hell itself. itself. People do empty activities and speak meaningless gibberish while others are forced to watch them. And the most depraved of all are forced to watch the watchers for all eternity.
But this is the most devilish form of punishment ever devised.
Indeed. Especially when the posh ones are.
And what have I done to deserve this fate?
You are doing now what I did all my life. You are an estate agent.
But people must be helped to find places to live. And from this I make an honest living, no more, no less.
Look at these chains that I must drag with me wherever I go. Each link is a buyer who thinks that their house does indeed have a most excellent aspect. Or a seller who fell for the line that only Scrooge and Marley could get them the best possible selling price.
But this is business. A business must make a profit to grow. It is the nature of things.
Imagine the fate that awaits you if you continue to think that way.
You mean Gogglebox for eternity?
It will certainly feel like that.
Then help me, Jacob. What must I do to avoid this fate?
You will be visited 3 more times tonight. First, at the stroke of midnight, a member of Her Majesty's tax inspectors will enter this very room.
But I paid tax at least once.
The second, on the instance of 1 a.m, will be from the Serious Fraud Office.
But they were trivial frauds!
And finally, your third visitor at 2 a.m. will be from Of Mizabdick.
Of Mizabdick? You mean?
Indeed. The office for the misuse and abuse of the writings of Charles Dickens.
But I am not responsible for this!
Only joking, old pal.
You mean I will not get these visits?
Oh, you will! But not from these three.
And who?
Not who, Ebenezer, but what? 3 spirits, each more terrible than the last, will enter this room at the times I have said.
Spirits, you said?
The dead, Ebenezer. They are devoid of life. They are pushing up the daisies. They've shuffled off this mortal coil and gone.
All right. Do not parrot me this stuff. These people come here expecting something completely different.
Just a favor of mine, that's all. So now it's time for business. Are you ready, boys? So be afraid, Ebenezer Scrooge! These visitations will lend your key to a better life. This is your chance to save yourself.
Jacob, you and I were friends, weren't we? We had a bit of a laugh together. You know that I'm a good man at heart.
You are, and always were, a miserable, self-centered little toad as far as I'm concerned. If I had my way, I would leave you to rot with me. But our author wants to show the value of a life turned around. Ho-hum, better get back to Gogglebox. I quite like the ones from Brighton, actually.
Did any of you see that?
No.
You must watch more carefully. Was there really a spirit? A ghost?
Yeah.
The living dead?
Yeah.
Well, I see a lot more out there. That is humbug. I shall now retire from my bed and lock my windows and doors. No spirit shall get through those. I also run a double glazing company, you know.
Mrs. Cratchit, Bob's wife.
here to show that Bob is a loving soul worthy of a family. In contrast to Mr. Scrooge, I don't have a name or a personality. These are my children, Martha and Peter and Eustace and Joseph.
Hello, nice to meet you all. Mother, what are all these people doing here?
Have they come for Christmas dinner?
Well, it's not going to go very far, is it? The remains of the cold thrush caught in Tiny Tim's beard.
Then why are they here?
Well, children, it's time to tell you that we are all characters in a book written by a very famous man called Charles Dickens.
Well, I've never heard of him.
That's because we're in his book, isn't it, Mum? He would have had to have written about himself in his own book for us to have known about him.
You're catching on fast, young lady. Very good for someone completely made up.
So why are they here?
Well, sort of. You see, a lot of people imitate Mr. Charles Dickens, and they don't always get it right.
Are we?
And we are fairly messed about.
And all these people have paid to watch this.
Amazing.
Hey, dudes, what's occurring? Part back with the avocados yet?
Oh, his hip condition just gets worse. I must put some flesh on his bones. I think I'll have to give him the thrush.
Oh, I'll take it on sourdough with some ducker. Cheers, Ma. Hello, loving family. Everyone excited about Christmas? What's that? But it's Christmas. Best time of the year. And we're all going to have a slap-up dinner of cold thrush.
I'm sorry, Bob. I had to give it to Tiny. When he turned sideways, you can hardly see him. I felt really sorry for the poor little fella.
Well, I'll just have to get us that huge turkey from the ginger pig's window.
Thanks, Daddy!
But Bob, a turkey from the ginger pig costs more than a holiday.
What's a holiday?
A holiday is where you go away and then you all fight and you get stranded in a tiny town in Eastern Europe that you've never heard of and you lose all your clothes. Or you go somewhere hot by the sea and you all get stomach upsets and then Dad steps on a sea urchin and we all have to pee on him and then when you get home you find out the house has been burgled.
Wow, that does sound expensive. And a turkey costs the same as all of that.
Don't worry, we'll get that turkey if it's the last thing we do. And then we'll have the biggest and best Christmas dinner ever. But then we'll share it with lots of poor, even more poor people than us. Because that's the way we were written.
Can't we just eat it all for ourselves and stuff the silly old man what wrote us?
Martha! Those words have been put into your mouth and they're spoiling the social meaning. I've warned you, you're mixing up the words and you're making it very confusing and you're destroying the meaning of the whole piece.
Sorry! That's normal.
Thank you.
I do love giving what little we have to those even more poor and more deserving. It makes me feel so incredibly smug and full of myself.
I warned you!
Sorry, just a slip.
Martha, say it again.
I do love doing what little we can. I just wish we could do more.
Yes, I gave some of that little thrush's beak that we had to all the children at the workhouse. And when they thanked me, I cried because I could do no more.
Oi! Rein it in a bit, will ya?
Righto, I think I've got it by now.
Look, I'm off. I'm going for a gong bath to clear my karmic blockage. Back in time for Christmas dinner, but don't forget the quinoa, yeah? I'll have to get that turkey for Tiny Tim if it's the last thing that I do. Just imagine the smile on his little face when he sits down for Christmas dinner. But now I'll have to get back to work and see if I can get a little overtime from Mr. Scrooge.
But Bob, it's past midnight, and Mr. Scrooge won't be there. He'll be back home, tucked up in his big, comfy bed.
I know, Mrs. Cratchit, but when he comes in the morning and sees that I've been working all night, he's bound to give me a little bonus. Bye now.
Bye. Bye. Oh, Bob, he's such a trusting soul. Even of that ghastly little wazzard, Scrooge. Oh, well, I suppose that's part of the story. Bunch of old tosh as far as I'm concerned. Come on, kids, let's go and get some run-over rats. Lovely hors d'oeuvres.
You go first, after you.
Good evening, madam. I fear we had a little misunderstanding the last time we met.
We did indeed. I listened to you. Here's your tea. Now scram!
Oh, thank you.
From beyond the grave has disturbed my tranquillity. It is humbug, you hear? It's all humbug. I shall now retire to my great goose down stuffed bed and sleep the sleep of the righteous. I hope you are watching, Jacob Marley. Making me very clever these days, you never know.
I am not a tax inspector. I am a visitor from the past, when I was quite well known, actually. Yes, my job is to show you where you have gone so terribly wrong when you should have brought harmony.
Went wrong? I'm the one in the goose down duvet.
Ah, but just in this life, Scrooge. And you are in that bed alone, are you not? Even I had Dennis to massage my feet.
Please, this is not a picture I wish to imagine.
But I have far worse for you, so stop slacking. Come on, we are going out.
Out? Are you mad?
Do I look mad?
Completely. But if we step outside of the door, it is pitch dark and snowing. I'm only in my nightshirt. I shall catch my death.
Who said anything about the door when you have a perfectly good window?
We're on the first floor. We shall just fall to the pavement. I'm not doing it. Just turn around and leave me alone.
You turn if you want to!
Come on!
This spirit is not for turning!
What shall we do?
It's good to see that weak men still like to do as I say. Now, take my hand, Scrooge, and we shall fly high into the night sky.
Really?
Well, no, not really. Obviously, it's only allegorical. We'll probably end up in the front row of the audience, but do at least try to look as if you're watching things as we fly overhead.
Well, let's get on with it.
And there are more and more people cramming. It gets really hot and sweaty, and people start fainting and passing out, and the cats come in and eat the dead ones.
Yeah,
right on.
Hello, everyone.
Hello.
What are you doing?
We're playing rotting fish for the new boy, Ebenezer.
Ebenezer what?
We've done that already. Come on, I'm going to find him first.
No, you won't.
Yes, I will.
Oh, no, you will not.
Oh, yes, I will.
I know you won't.
I'm Belle. Are you Ebenezer?
Yes.
Nice name, better than Fezziwig. Can I hide with you?
Oh yes, that would be nice.
Oh, we'll have to squeeze in really tight.
Oh, I like this.
Me too.
Gosh, it feels like...
Found you.
Oh, you're cozy.
We're very cozy, actually. It's rather disappointing to be found, actually.
Oh, gosh, Belle.
Gosh, it feels like we've been here for ages.
Crikey, 3 years have passed. We're in our early teens.
Yeah, I'm off.
I say, Fezzy, you and I are best of friends, aren't we?
We certainly are. And we'll probably go into business together. And I'll be really nice to people, but you'll be too interested in the money.
Gosh, Fezzy, I bet we will.
Yeah, it'd be a great counterpoint to the win-at-all-costs approach that you and Jacob Marley would adopt later in life.
Wacko, Fezzy, you're an absolute hoot. Should we go and find more of my many friends? That's showing what a fun-loving, outgoing and jolly sort of person I used to be.
Yeah, we can all play innocently with penny whistles and have harmless play fights.
Hello, Ebenezer.
Oh my, it's Belle. It's time.
Well, you never got to have an
do not remind me, Spinach.
I'm sorry, but that's rather the point, please. And anyway, if I didn't remind you, I'd be accepting defeat. And I don't recognise the word defeat.
Hello, Ebenezer. Hello, Fezziwig.
Nice.
Can I play with you?
We're boys, and boys can get pretty rough, you know.
Well, I'd like you to play with us. I think you're...
What, Ebenezer? What do you think I am?
You love her. Ebby loves Belly. Ebby loves Belly.
Do you, Ebenezer? Do you love me?
Yes, I jolly well do. I don't care what old Fezziwig says.
Oh, and I love you too, Ebenezer. It would be terrible if you were persuaded to follow a selfish path in life, driven by a lust for personal wealth, and you behaved so badly, you ended our relationship before it had a chance to bloom.
There'll be just a thing to turn you from a generous, big-hearted fellow into an inward-looking, self-centered old bigot without a positive thought for others.
Well, I can't see that happening. Come on, should we get together after school with a jolly threesome and play joyfully?
Yes, let's!
Foundations may get the skeletons from the graveyard and place to build on.
And people want that.
They do if they're original. Of course, it helps if it's near Victoria Park as well.
But how do we make money?
Oh, Ellen, Lisa. It's so easy. The first lot really wants to sell, so they'll take anything. The second lot are desperate to buy, so they'll pay as much as they can afford. Possibly even more. The difference is called introduction fees, commission, arrangement fees, rat clearing fees.
Ah, but there aren't any rats.
You're getting it. And the buyers will need a mortgage, so we get them that as well.
Ah, the buyers couldn't afford to make the mortgage repayments, and we haven't got the money to lend them.
We don't need any money because the sellers are selling for much less than the buyers are buying. All the buyers need to know is that the mortgage enables them to buy the property. Don't need to know the actual price it's being sold for. You don't want to go there, neither party needs to know that. So, they give us as much as they can. They borrow money that we don't have and that they can't afford to buy a house from someone who gets virtually nothing selling a house they don't really want to leave.
Oh, and Jacob, when they can't afford to make the mortgage repayments, then...
Yes, yes,
then we get the house!
Hallelujah, he's got it! Are we in business?
We are, Jacob, Scrooge Marley and Scrooge. Marley, estate agents.
We'll work that one out later. Come on, let's go make some real
yeah, come on.
Hello, Ebenezer. Hello, Jacob. What are you two talking about?
Oh, nothing you'd understand. Come on, Ebenezer.
I don't trust that Jacob Marley. He's just trying to persuade my parents to sell their house. He says they're going to build a great open sewer right through it. Do you think they are?
Don't know, I think... Oh, yes. Now I come to think they definitely are. They're going to knock the house down and build a great big sewer to take all that filthy waste from the even more common people to the north.
My parents really should sell their house.
Oh yes, because if they don't, the rotten old mayor will just knock it down for the sewer.
Oh, thank you, Ebenezer. I loved you already, but now you've saved my parents from losing their house, I know that you're thoughtful, caring and honest as well. I must rush and tell them.
You are a natural. I had tears in my eyes. I really believe they're building that sewer, and I'm the one who made the story up.
What about Belle?
Oh, what about her? When the cash starts to roll, then you can have your pick from a whole field of bells. You forget all about that one. Just you wait and see.
Come on, let's go make some money.
Yeah, there's a house in South.
And did you, Scrooge? Did you forget all about her?
Yes, I did. Of course, when her parents forced to sell the house to Scrooge and Marley and went to live in the workhouse and died a horrible death of consumption, she went off me a bit. I didn't care then.
And do you now, Scrooge?
Take me back, spirit. I can take no more.
Very well. Let's hope you've learned something. Some people need a bit of an iron fist. This spirit has one. Come, take my hand. We'll fly again over the rooftops, this time with British Airways. They were a proper airline in my day. Do hold tightly to your nightgown. We don't want people looking up and thinking Rudolph's red nose has shriveled away.
Images of my youth. But it was all nonsense, of course. I was asleep the whole time, wasn't I?
No.
Was I asleep?
No.
I wasn't asleep?
No.
You mean it was real?
Yes.
Oh, no. If it had been real, it was very cold up there in my nightshirt. I would have caught a terrible cold. Oh, excuse me one moment, please. Oh, goodness. Maybe it was colder than I thought. No, it is. Really, it is all nonsense. I should get some more sleep. I'm not feeling well. I'll be up in the morning at 8 o'clock to go into the office. Look, there it is. It is time already.
Pantomime?
No, it isn't.
Oh, thank you very much. I'm going to look
come on, here we go, ready?
Behind you!
I mean, there's nobody there. You are making fun of old Scrooge.
Behind you!
Behind you. All right, one more time, just to prove I'm right. Because I'm usually right. Here we go.
Who are you?
Isn't it obvious? I am Christmas Present. Christmas Present. See? People do try me to try a bit more humour.
Perhaps it's the way you tell them.
My coming was foretold, was it not?
I hear it was a rather nasty shock for most people.
I mean, somebody told you, didn't he?
I was warned. What are you going to show me? Have I cheated in my cycling proficiency test? Or stole my grandmother's Zimmer frame when she was in the toilet?
My job is to show you how decent, hard-working, honest families spend Christmas. I'm sort of an early Facebook. I will show you completely unrealistic images of happy, smiley, lovely people with lots of friends having a marvellous life until your own self-esteem is ground down and you think you are like a complete loser.
But that is terrible cruelty.
Yes, it is. The only difference is, Scrooge, you are a complete loser. You just don't know it.
Very well. If we're going to fly again, let me put some underpants on, please.
Fly? That is not the strong and stable way.
Well, what shall we do? This does seem awfully chaotic, doesn't it?
That is not the strong and stable way.
Well, so you say, but...
That is not the strong and stable way. 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 Thank you. I sometimes get myself into a strong and stable loop.
Well, what shall we do then?
We shall go down there and sit with those children.
But they are revolting.
See it from my point of view, Scrooge. I have to hold hands with a lot more unpleasant people than you. Now come along.
Well, very well, but how do we get out of my bedroom?
By the exit, Mr. Scrooge. And exit means exit.
It's the interval for 20 minutes.
What a sad little hovel.
Bedsit.
What's a bedsit?
Bedsit means bedsit.
Come on, children. We've got to get ready for Christmas. Got to make the puddings. Your auntie's coming to help.
Auntie Nigella?
Oh, Mum. No, she can't.
She's so weird.
We don't understand what she goes on about.
And she talks so posh. Why don't we have a posh own?
And I bet she's not historically accurate, Mum, is she?
She's not even anatomically accurate. But you know what they say? You can choose your friends, but your family's made up by the plonkers what wrote this.
When is she coming?
Generally, she's always in this thing. She does it, she's considered to be one for the dads. And this lot, they've got to expect it.
When can they...
Oh, when? Well, she comes on in the second half to stop the adults going to the pub. Now, come on, let's put on a cheery show for that Mr. Scrooge. Let's make the puddings.
Hurrah! We're going to mix the pudding! What did it this year?
I heard the sticky dates. I love sticky dates.
No, Pete. Call back with the avocados.
Now, let's get this straight. We haven't had a date in our puddings for years. And as for you, speaking in tongues again, you are. Now, here's the recipe, and I want you to pick up the stuff. Now, it says flour, but we can't afford flour and have it for several years. So we'll have to make do with dandruff. What? We do have a few pennies. Keep it there.
Right.
Pour it in! Oh. Oh. Lovely and flaky. Oh. Oh, look at that. Oh, lovely and flaky. Perfect roughage. Mmm. And a good few egg lice as well for protein. What next?
Look. If you won't put avos in, will you at least put some quinoa in? My beard needs the enzymes.
Come on, Tiny. Come on, Tim. I'll help you stir.
Look, sis. No quinoa, no San Patin.
Come on, Tim. I'll help you. Up again.
Look, family. Really appreciate the offers, but it just doesn't do it for me. Comprendo?
Tim, come and sit on my knee.
Oh boy, it just doesn't wax my tash, Mark. I'm going out on the fixie for a flat white and a gluten-free polenta bake. Later!
What a terrible condition the poor little chap has. Can nothing be done?
Perhaps a little more coming into the family.
I pay a fair wage. This is not my responsibility. You will not make me feel guilty for the problems these people bring upon themselves.
Keep watching, Mr. Scrooge.
For how much longer? These chairs are completely inadequate.
If you want this lot to hang around, I wouldn't make too much of that if I was you.
Oh, well, Tiny's clearly not up to it, so we'll have to do this mixing ourselves. Now, what have we got so far?
Dandruff! Head lice!
My mouth's watering already. But we need fruit.
I know about fruit. We did it at school.
Yeah, someone put in a really weird apple that a really posh lady from a stagecoach threw at him after the mother knocked down his mother and killed her.
Oh, it's so good to hear that there are some kind, loving people in the aristocracy, I must say. So, what have we got so far? Dandruff?
Head lice?
Head lice.
What about the fruit? Where can we get the fruit?
There's the best place ever. You know, Peter, where the sewer comes into the house and there's a nice damp piece of wood? There's a lovely crop of fungus there. Marvellous flavour! Off you go, Peter.
Is it safe?
Safest houses.
The house next door fell down yesterday and all 23 members of the family died horribly.
As I said, safest houses! You snowflake, so sensitive! Ah, here's Peter with the fungus. Throw it in! Oh, look at that, lovely! Gonna need some sugar!
Where can I find that?
We've used the dandruff already, haven't we? I know where there's something gritty! Granny's socks!
Right, Homer!
Off you go! That's looking lovely, isn't it, kids?
Here we go, Mark. Granny was a bit mixed.
All right.
But when I told her what it was for, she scraped out her toenails and gave us that as well.
Oh, lovely, lovely. Wonderful tang that's going to give it.
Oh. Is it ready to cook, Mark?
With that? Currants and raisins? What kind of Christmas pudding would that be?
I've seen lots of currants around when the rats come in.
Oh, you're catching on fast, Peter. Off you go. And get the nice red ones!
What else, Mum? Doesn't it need eggs?
Yes, it needs lovely fresh eggs.
Can Granny help again?
I think Granny's used all her eggs up, but there's a lot of pigeons in her room, and if there's pigeons, there's eggs. But if there isn't any eggs, get the dead ones, because it's the same stuff, really, isn't it?
Okay.
Off you go, Martha. Oh, Peter, you're learning fast. Oh, lovely, lovely.
Oh. Here we go, Matt. Couldn't find any eggs, but these pigeons have just died, so they must have some eggs in them.
Okay, shut up. Let's give it a bit of a stir. And, not quite yet. And, now we need some drink.
Yeah, hey, family mine. Making the pudding, vegan, I hope.
What's vegan mean?
It's someone who doesn't eat the maggots in the bread.
We haven't put any maggots in there, have we, kids?
Well, there is something moving in there.
No. I think when we put the drink in, it'll all stop.
Hey, yeah, what are these? They look like chia seeds. Wow, that is the best chia I've ever eaten.
Oh, poor Tim. He tries so hard, but he's just getting worse. What kind of drink would you like in it?
Give it a bottle of 5 Points London Smoke, or if we're really desperate, I suppose some Brewdog Dead Pony would be just the right side of cool.
What's Tim talking about, Mark?
I don't know, he just gets weirder and weirder.
I know. There's a jug of something frothy in the bedroom. Why don't we use that?
Well, we've drunk it once, so it must be all right. Oh, yes. Oh, yeah, pour it in, Peter. Now, let's give it a lucky stir.
Hello, my lovely, warm-hearted family, who have perfectly illustrated the importance of mutual family support.
Hello, Daddy.
In stark contrast to Mr. Scrooge's entirely self-absorbed outlook.
Now, look here!
It's no good shouting, Mr. Scrooge. You're not really here. This is just a metaphor.
Isn't it exciting? It's Christmas Day tomorrow!
We are excited, but we realise because of our dire financial situation, we cannot expect more than the simplest of gifts and foodstuffs.
Aren't they great kids, Mrs. Cratchit?
The very best we could expect, given our dire nutrition and dreadful living conditions.
How's my best boy, eh, Tiny?
Hey, Pa, just chill a mo. Just ordering a box of vegan avocado cocoa-free chocolate cookies.
That's my boy. Isn't he great, Mrs. Cratchit? He never complains about his awful condition. If only we could afford to give him the Christmas he wants.
The Christmas he deserves!
I can help them.
You can help them, sir. But you already paid Bob's wages. What more can you do?
I don't know. I just had a strange feeling inside. Indigestion, no doubt. I should not have received one of Grumpy John's twice frozen pies at the interval.
You're softening, Mr. Scrooge.
I am not. Let us watch more of how these people spend their miserable Christmas.
Come on, me dearios. Let's give the pudding a stir, put it on the boil, and then we can all go carol singing. Let's give it a lucky stir.
Don't forget to make a wish now. I'm wishing for a perfect Christmas for poor little Tiny Tim.
Yeah, right, look. I don't really dig this Christmas thing. It's just a huge commercial exercise designed to rip more money off the poor and gullible. All derived from ancient and discredited notions of a big god figure in the sky with a badly maintained beard, sending us all a whole series of pointless challenges based on artificial moral foundations. But I'll have some chia seed pudding if there's any going.
And I'm wishing for you too, Tim. I'm wishing for you too. He just gets worse and worse.
Hey, I just had a WhatsApp from the dudes at the bar. The Beardy Plonkers are playing, and there's a vegan avocado pop-up. I'm going to have to sack off the carol singing this year. YOLO!
Look, the spoon's melted.
Lovely, it's a good strong pudding. Let's put it on to boil and then we'll all go carol singing. Is the fire ready?
Oh, Bob, there's so little left to burn.
What about Granny?
Martha, whatever are you saying? We can't burn your Granny. She's much too dry. She'll go out like a Roman candle.
I meant her floorboards.
Oh.
Peter had a great idea.
Yeah, if we bounce her bed on the beams, and then if she needs anything, we can push it up through the hole.
Oh, what thoughtful children. Let's do it.
Go on, everybody. Let's put the wood under there. Right, that'll burn now. Let's all go carol singing. Right.
Hang on.
Hello! I'm collecting four!
Children, you know what I'm doing. Happy Christmas!
It is not how I do. They were all helping each other, and although they have no wealth, and are in many respects quite disgusting, they seem...
happy, Mr. Scrooge.
Yes, happy. I remember. Happy. Take me back now. Spirit.
Wait! Who is this?
Ah, this is more like it. I think I might stay and watch this one.
Where did they all go? That looks tasty. Delicious. Although I must say, I would have added rather more currants as a seasoned professional. They're so juicy and have a wonderful animal tang that's somehow familiar and yet hard to place. I'm terribly sorry, I've forgotten to introduce myself. I'm Bob's sister, Nigella. But I left the family house. And judging by the state of the place, I'm awfully glad that I did. No, I made my life at the other end of the social spectrum. Yes, I married a rather fine aristocrat. But don't think that I simply rode to my fortune on the back of his noble flagpole. No, I was very well known for teaching other fine families how to entertain their guests. You see, I have a special feel for the finer hunks of flesh and the juiciest plums and the firmest standing spears of proud-headed asparagus and the sweetest of hand-squeezed juices. But I do like to take care of the lower orders. I throw them pomegranate from my coach. You know, there really is something in Tiny Tim's lust for avocado pears and organic artisanal fruits. It's one of the ways that I get my hipster thrills. Avocados. You must get a perfectly ripe one of a decent size. There is nothing to compare with the feel of a good, heavy pear. That's firm, but with a touch of softness under the fingertips. One of my favorite thrills is peeling an avocado pear. I like to take a sharp knife and draw it from the top to the bottom of the fruit, as though tickling a loved one's tenderloin. I slip the tip of my finger under the skin, and you'll find you can pull it like a zip fastener. Insert the finger a little further, and you come to the round, smooth outline of the center. If you squeeze it a little, it'll pop out, all shiny and slippery. A delight to hold in the hand. And if you pop it somewhere warm and not too dry, it might just grow for you. Now, for the flesh, it needs plenty of pepper from the biggest Italian grinder you can get two hands around. Now, the sourdough. And we do know what lies behind a forceful sourdough. A woman. The mother. The tireless yeast starter that turns your dough from a limp, pappy, lifeless little lump into a great, powerful, swollen beast with a tangy taste and a smell like recently washed axilla. So, pop the starter in a lovely china bowl and mix her with a couple of rough house flowers. One strong and white, the other gritty and unrefined. Add some warm water, not too hot, you don't want to scald them. They need to be comfortable with each other to work their magic together. Roll them and squeeze them and cover them with a warm cover and let them really get to work. And that's where the real magic happens, when the strong white and the rough farmhouse grow and swell and lift up the cover like a duvet lifting upwards by, oh, I don't know, perhaps a slowly raised knee. And when they've all come nicely together, take the warm and, let us hope, not too sticky results and form them into the rough shape of a mortadella di Parma. That's a whopping great sausage to some folk. And slip it into a nice warm oven. You know, I had lunch with a hipster once. He had a great long beard and an unfortunate piercing through his nose made him look like a proper Prince Albert. Such an innocent boy. Well, young man, really. And I think being in the presence of a worldly woman made him quite nervous. He was eating his pomegranate seed quinoa and a kale blancmange. And as he scooped it out of the tiny little glass test tube that was served him, so great, his chopsticks slipped and some of it fell onto my cloudberry jelly yam floured muffin. And it spilled all over the floor. Well, I must say he was very game. He dived right under the table, but he got his beard caught in the sticky furry coating of my muffin, and all the soft center oozed out. In the end, we had to repair to the wonderful new water closet to finish the job and separate ourselves properly. But I really must go now before those awful relatives of mine return. Bye, and remember, be careful where you spill your pomegranate seed.
Come along, Scrooge. I think you've seen enough. It is time to take you back to the warmth of your goose down bed. A luxury that these people will never have, yet you take completely for granted.
This is fake news! What I've said about me is perfect because I'm perfect. Nobody's seen anything so perfect before. These spirits, they're your enemies, enemies of the people. You and I, we're on the same side. There's good and bad in everyone. I've made mistakes. I may have put a few people in the poorhouse, ruined a few lives, caused the early death of some unnecessary children, and enriched myself with obscure but beautiful financial agreements. But that makes me smart. These Cratchits, these other people, they do bad stuff, you know, so bad. I know. Why don't we have a little vote? Yes? Yeah. All those who think that I am just so great, stand up and cheer now. Ha! Now, if there's anybody left, anybody want to stand and cheer for these spirits and their fake news? And these Cratchits and their alternative facts? Come on, any of you?
Yay! Yay!
Spirits!
So it seems, Scrooge.
Yes. I thought that was pretty clear. That was the largest number of people standing up for me that anybody's seen standing up for anybody ever before in history. Period.
No! Trumpy!
Come along, Scrooge. It will take a little bit more before you're strong and stable.
We wish you a Merry Christmas, we wish you a Merry Christmas, we wish you a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. Come on everybody, let's sing carols. Okay, wrap up, Ward. And we'll wait for the others here.
Hello, Fezziwig.
Hello. Where's Cheerall?
Where have you been, Fezziwig?
Oh, well, I'm one of those minor characters who keep on getting forgotten, and here we are. Scene 9, and this lot have realised I haven't appeared yet.
Weren't you in that earlier scene where Scrooge sees his younger life?
Yes, there was a good-looking and intelligent actor playing me, but he didn't get to say much and then just disappeared.
Well, it's good to have you along, Fezziwig. Who else are we waiting for?
What about Uncle Fred?
He's not your real uncle, you know. He's Mr. Scrooge's nephew.
What's he for?
He's here to show that we all have a free choice in life. Even though he's from the same family as Mr. Scrooge, he's chosen a different path.
And is he in his play?
Oh, that depends how many actors we have. If we have a few spares looking for a role, we won't have too many lines to learn. He'll be along soon.
Carol singing outside my horrible Uncle Scrooge's house.
Hello, cameo role, Fred. It's good that you came along. You saved me making another bit of scenery.
Mr. Scrooge isn't all that bad, you know. He pays my wages.
Oh, Bob, Bob, Bob. It's people like you, all meek and mild, who allow horrible people like my uncle to make all his money. Try singing a couple of carols and see what happens.
In a trice, oh, why must you be our sole agents? Our sole agents, oh, why must you be our sole agents?
Do you mind if I join you? All that carol singing will have put everyone in a Christmassy mood.
Now, be off me! I do not need your maudlin caterwauling at this time of night. I have to be up in the morning to go into the office, and you are depriving me of sleep. If you do not leave immediately, I will bring the full force of the law down upon you.
Hooray!
come on, everyone.
Uncle Scrooge, would you like to come round to our house for Christmas Day?
I would rather be dead in a stinking ditch beneath the rotting carcasses of diseased sheep than spend a day with you and your dreadful family.
So I'll take that as a maybe?
I think his rehabilitation is taking a little bit longer than expected.
Oh well, come on everyone. Once the contents of Mr. Scrooge's chamber pot have dried, I'm sure we'll be welcome elsewhere. Come along, keep on singing!
God rest you, stay gentle,
these dreams most unsettling, whilst I enjoy nothing more than emptying my chamber pot over the smug, grinning faces of carol singers. Yet I cannot avoid a feeling of warmth towards them, and even a desire to join them. Join them! I ask you. No, I am not well, that is the answer. I shall retire to bed now, and be in the office at 8 o'clock. Look, it is, well, very nearly. There. Now it is 2:15 already. Too late for any so-called visitor from beyond the grave. It is humbug, you hear? Humbug, 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 humbug. Humbug, 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 humbug. Humbug, humbug, humbug.
See, look,
there.
Ah, it is a carnival of some sort. Foolish people. What do they have to be so happy about? This looks like a very promising property. I wonder where it is.
What a wonderful day it is. Even Tiny Tim's almost smiling.
Yeah, hang on a minute, Mo. Hang on a minute, Mark. I just heard that there are vegan avocados at the deli downstairs. I've got to go. This guy won't miss me in his condition. Come on, guys. Let's put the signs down here, and then we can all have a glass of mulled wine.
Can we have some wine?
Of course you can. Yeah. There aren't going to be many days like this, and if you drink water, you'll probably get cholera.
This is a tomb. I wonder whose it is.
Oh, do keep up, Mr. Scrooge. It's not somebody they like very much, or they wouldn't be having such a good time.
Well, Jacob Marley was not widely liked, but his tomb is old and moss-covered. Look, it is over there. When we were partners, we often spoke about after our death that we would be buried close to... This is my tomb?
10 out of 10, Mr. Scrooge. Would you care to pull on my wee cracker? No, care to have a blow on my humorous whistle?
But... this is my tomb! My grave! How can you behave like this? And people dance and sing? Am I so hated?
Yes!
Well... the names won't mean much to you yet, but you're up there in the popularity stakes with Harvey Weinstein, Piers Morgan, that wee Katie off The Apprentice, Kim Jong-un, Osama Bin Laden, Gary Glitter, all the 70s TV presenters except Ryan Cannon, that lovely wee Tony Hart, oh aye, and a fella called Trump.
What must I do?
Well, you can cheer up and stop feeling so sorry for yourself. Oh, poor me. Nobody loves me. Everybody hates me. All I'm trying to do is make a bit of money. Oh, it's so unfair.
This is how I sound.
Well, I haven't quite got the answer yet, but it's a fair effort, I like to think.
Is this true?
Yes.
This is really how I am?
Yes.
Only if you invite me to your Christmas dinner, if I remain as I am.
No!
Come on, let's get you back to your bed. You've got to get to work in the morning.
Work? On Christmas morning? Are you mad? Take me back! We must get that turkey for Tiny Tim!
Well, I think you prefer avocado on toast.
Not for Christmas! These hipsters have to lighten up! Come on, let's go!
Thank you.
think this one might have some cockroaches in it.
Oh, not fair. I want that one.
Hello, my lovely children. Don't go spoiling the surprises now.
When is Dad coming home?
He'll be home very soon. But Mr. Scrooge doesn't seem to quite understand the work-life balance.
That's not fair. We love it when Dad comes home. It's not a proper Christmas until Daddy comes home. Scrooge is a miserly minger.
Scrooge is a stingy scumbag.
Scrooge is a horrid old humbug.
Scrooge is a...
Scrooge,
Scrooge is a horrid old humbug!
Scrooge! What an unexpected expectoration! What an honour and surprise to see you!
But it is Christmas Day, Mrs. Cratchit! Christmas!
Then why is my husband slaving in your office?
But he isn't, Mrs. Cratchit! He's right behind me! And he's brought a little gift for me to your fantastic family! There's never been a fantastic family this fantastic! And I paid for the present! Come on, Bob, don't keep them guessing!
Oh.
Hello, my... Finally seen the error of his ways.
Well, we've never seen a bird like it. It's huge.
Yes, it is the biggest den that there's ever been. No argument.
Yo, who's the dude with the tarkus?
Ah, this must be Tiny Tim. I see what you mean, Bob. He does indeed need our help.
Now listen. I live with the planet. I love with the planet. I breathe with the planet. I don't eat its animals.
Oi! Tim! Why can't you just enjoy what Mr. Scrooge has given to you? Why can't you be like everybody else?
Oh no, Mrs. Cratchit, don't you see? Tim is right. Just as I have only ever looked after my own welfare, so we have given no thought to our planet. Just as I've treated poor dear Bob here as my slave, we have enslaved the entire animal kingdom. We must all stop eating animals and living off what we've forced them to produce. Oh, measure of support. We must all consume only what is made in small artisanal workshops. We must all ride fixed gear bicycles. And grow huge but carefully trimmed beards. We must all be hipsters.
You are High Key the Goat.
Well, I don't know what you mean, but I'll take it as a compliment. Ah, more guests. Ah, more guests. Ah, more guests.
Hello, Uncle Scrooge. It's not like you to be out of the office on Christmas Day.
Ah, that was the old Scrooge, Fred. It's going to be so different from now on. So different.
Can I introduce you to someone, Ebenezer?
There is no need. My dear, you have not changed one hair on your beautiful head since we last spoke.
Well, that's the magic of pantomime on a very small budget.
You have missed me?
Well, yes. And once I knew a kind, thoughtful, and fun-loving young man, in his place were a monster that turned his back on me.
But the life has aged, well, Ebenezer.
You were quite as lined and ugly as I have remained smooth and lovely. But I think I see the signs of life returning.
You mean perhaps we could turn the clock back and once again be a couple?
No, I mean, you can try your luck on Tinder, Happn, Sparkle, or Grindr, but things have changed, Ebenezer. It's been a long time.
Oh, come on, this is all too silly. Is the writer still there?
Yes!
This was supposed to be about big turkeys, Tiny Tim with a big smile on his face. But what do we get? Avocados, hipsters, dating websites! Ah! Is she back then? Not going to change anything, is it?
Try it.
Yes.
You don't think she has the scrolls, do you?
Have you got the scrolls yet?
Not yet, but if I keep sitting like this, I will. Here you go.
Then it, come on.
Have a good hold.